Eluded as soon as we get a thumbs up that we're online. Thank you, Drew. Good morning to all. Stand with me if you would. Let's start our service today with the Star Spangled Banner, 576. This being July 4th week and the birth of our nation, we honor it with this song. Play ball. Amen. Yes. Well, let's start today with a word of prayer. Father, we are so blessed today to live in a country where freedom is what we think of after we sing that great song. And it's encapsulated in that phrase, let's play ball. Just the freedom that surrounds us in this great country that we live in. And we thank you for it. Thank you for that song, the truth that is presented in it. And from little kids, how we've learned that song as the clarion call of freedom. I pray, Father, that you bless us today as we focus on freedom and your word. And bless us, I pray, bless your word, bless all that happens today in your precious name. We do pray, Father, that you would be with the cousin of Anne, Larry, who's in Georgia undergoing surgery right as we speak. We pray, Father, that you'd be with him and the problem that he has with his neck from a construction accident. Ask, Lord, that you'd be with him especially and with those that do the surgery today. Lord, it's good to have Becky with us today and the post-death of her brother. And I pray, Father, that you would be with her and minister to her today in a special way, as I know that you already have been. For others that are visiting with us today, how wonderful it is to see their face and know that they've taken time out of their schedule to be with us. I pray, Father, they will not be disappointed, that your word will reign and that your people will be wonderful, and we'll give you praise for all that done in Jesus' name. Amen. Shake hands with one another. Amen. Looks like Opal has stole the show back there. Amen. Amen. Well, Opal, I think, caught the show back there. Everybody was wanting to see the baby. And nice to see her this morning. Mom and Dad doing okay back there? All right. Well, Mom said yes. Oh, there's the other one. Hello, buddy. How you doing? Amen. What a blessing to have new births. Amen. Wonderful. Take your hymnal once again, and let's sing 569. I'll ask you to stand once again as we sing this. Hard to sing this song sitting down, amen? 569, the battle hymn of the Republic. 569.
Mind eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the enemy's banner, great.
Very good. We are going to dismiss the kids at this time. They can make their way to junior church. Bye, Luke. See you later, bud. That's a dangerous thoroughfare. I'm glad Opal is coming up in the rear there, yeah. Amen. Wonderful. And now Diana plays "We're Marching to Zion." Thank you, Diane. I saw all those fingers moving at the same time. I used to play trumpet. Well, you have to use your imagination. I had a trumpet, and it had three notes. And how many, is it eight that are on that? Eight different spots on your, yeah, amazing. Okay, a lot of different alternatives there to remember all those notes. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. We're marching to Zion. And good to have you with us. We got some visitors today. We're glad to have you with us. Honored guest you are. And we hope that you sense that and feel that when you leave. We'd mean that sincerely. Never take you for granted. And you could have been a lot of places today. That you're here means a lot to us. And we hope that we don't disappoint. We have sang today songs from our hymn book about this great period of time that we're living. This week, Thursday, will be our July 4th National Day of Independence celebration. And in coordination with that, and with the thought of that, I thought it would be appropriate to bring a sermon today on freedom. And so if you have your Bibles, take it with me to John chapter 8. If you didn't bring your Bible today, in front of you is a pew Bible. It looks just like this, and it is page 692. We encourage you to follow along with us. You know, preachers, they blavocate so much. They just on and on and on. They just keep talking, and it's nice to know that some of what they say really comes from the Bible, so we always encourage people to turn in their Bible and follow along so that they know that what we say is what God said, and not something that we came up with on our own. So page 692 in that book, Bible, that's in front of you, we'd be delighted to have you be a part of it watching with us today. For those that don't have a Bible or it's just hard to read, sometimes that print there is kind of small. We've also put it on the overhead for you so that you can take a look at it. John chapter 8 and there, page 692. Notice what it says. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Now, I read it that way because it's kind of a sarcastic, defiant statement. They weren't making just a statement. They were saying, you said we can be free, and we're Abraham's seed, and we've never been in bondage to any man. How in the world can you say that? Ye shall be made free. Jesus goes on to speak, and he says, he answers them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. Servant, bondage. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth ever. If the son, therefore, notice the capital S, that's the name of a person, not just a son, any son, but Jesus. If the son, therefore, make you free, ye shall be free indeed. In this passage of scripture that we've read, Jesus is speaking to a group of Jews about spiritual freedom. And as I mentioned, I thought it appropriate today to spring off this idea into our sermon because this Thursday is the 4th of July. As you know, I'm sure, on this date in 1776, the Continental Congress introduced to the world the Declaration of Independence, a document which separated the American colonies at that time from the British Empire. And therefore, it is this document, who we show in part before you, that declares our national freedom from England. You may or may not know this, and you might wonder why there's a connection here, but I'll explain it as we get through it. But at each annual Passover meal, which is the Jews' declaration of freedom from Egypt, so many, many years ago in the Old Testament, it is a Jewish tradition for the youngest, you see the arrow, the white arrow there in the picture, from the youngest child to ask the family patriarch, which is a big word for father, what makes this night different from any other? That question then opens the door for anyone around the table, in this case, the family that's present, for everyone or anyone to introduce a remembrance of that special working of God in the lives of the nation of Israel during that famous night of the Exodus. I thought about that and I wondered, what would we say if that practice was used with regards to our holiday of independence? Maybe we would pose this question to those that were gathered with us for an outdoor barbecue or maybe inside at the house around the kitchen table. And we would say, what makes July 4th different than any other day? I don't think that you have to be scratching to realize that the further that we move as a nation away from our founding, the more and more necessary it is to remind our younger generation coming up where our heritage began. And so we might ask that question, what makes July 4th different than any other day? While Independence Day doesn't have the same biblical and spiritual stature as the Passover celebration for the nation of Israel did, it is our country's most important holiday. It does define the dime and the document that set the whole ball rolling of our independence. And you may find it surprising, it is rich in spiritual heritage. And as we understand this holiday that we're going to celebrate, and the Declaration of Independence that began it, we can see a spiritual parallel of those instruments and that desire with what Jesus spoke of in the text that we looked at today. And I'd like for you to just walk through me. It's really pretty simple. Most of you could preach this sermon without a problem today. It's pretty, I mean, you're like a, it's like a sitcom comedy. What makes it funny is you already know what's going to make you laugh. You know it ahead of time. So you're just waiting for it to happen so that you can let it go. Ha, 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 ha. So this is one of those sermons. You're going to be able to preach it long before I get to the point. And if you'll indulge me at the right time, say amen. All right. First of all, consider with me, if you would, our nation's freedom. Our nation's freedom. Our first consideration would be the cost of pursuing it. Benjamin Franklin said in addressing the assembly before the signing of the Declaration, said, "We must all hang together, or assuredly we shall hang separately." He was speaking about the cost that they were making when they signed that document that we know of as the Declaration of Independence. Understand, if you would with me today, the presentation of that document to the King of Britain took place in the midst, as you can see the picture here before you, of the midst of an exceeding and existing military conflict. I mean, it was bad already. The document, when received by the king, would be perceived as an official declaration of war by the American colonies. It would say, "We want to be separate from you, and we are going to declare war if you do not acknowledge this document." And this was clearly understood by all those who signed that document that day. Listen to the last sentence on that document. "And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence," notice the capital P, name of a person, "we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor." That they knew that the cost of national freedom that day, when they signed that document, was going to be great. And indeed, the costs were staggering. The American Revolution, which took place from 1775 to 1783, took 8 years. 8 years of carnage. Many of the defenders of this document died without even enjoying the benefits. And I think how that is through the centuries, many people have fought on America's battlefronts for a freedom they never got to enjoy themselves, or spend in their waning years of life the enjoyment from their benefit. The benefit from their labors. The signers of the Declaration of Independence were paid an extremely high cost. In fact, 5 of the signers were captured and tortured to death by the British. 12 of them had their homes destroyed and everything they owned taken from them. They were left destitute in a society that did not have a Medicaid system. 2 lost their sons in the war. Think of that, men, fathers. Making a commitment to sign your John Henry, if you would, on a piece of paper that declared war against a British empire, and realizing that it could not only cost you your life, but cost the lives of your son. 9 died from wounds or hardships suffered during the war. There were great costs in pursuing our nation's freedom. And we could go down from the American Revolution all the way through the current time of all the great losses and sacrifices that were made for people who loved not their life unto the death for the sake of protecting the freedom that we enjoy. It burns me up. I mean, I spent 8 years in the Marine Corps. I never saw any battle at all. I was good with a pencil, but not with a rifle. Amen. So I did really good at writing on things, but not too good at shooting at things. But I went in with all of my high school buddies that were the close buddies of me, and every one of them were killed in Vietnam. Every one of them. It exacts a terrible toll. If I close my eyes right now, I can see the face of each one of those young men, 18 years of age, didn't even know which way was up. Every one of them. I'll go. I'll fight. They died. We live. The cost is staggering of what it costs for freedom. Notice, secondly, if you would with me, the godly nature of our nation's freedom. The godly nature of pursuing and the formation of this great nation. The Declaration of Independence is firmly based on scriptural truth. And I know that revisionists and revisionism today is trying to destroy these documents and destroy these words and muddy the waters or just dilute them completely away. But this is a document that you can find still, and it tells the truth. Notice, if you would, just a few of the sentences of this great document. The first one is this: we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their what? Creator. Capital C. It's the name of a person. It was founded on biblical truth, with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. If you scan down through the document a little bit more, it says, we therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress assembled, appealing to, again, the name of a person, the Supreme Judge of the world. Notice both letters capitalized, meaning we're talking about a person. A person. It was rooted in biblical truth. Notice again, down there towards the end, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence. They believed that God was on their side. The men who formed this document held the Bible in one hand as they wrote the Declaration of Independence with the other. It has a biblical basis. It was not the concoction of somebody that had a better idea, but they relied upon the divine providence of God, the Word of God, to make the document that we now call the Declaration of Independence. There's a reason why, no matter what political party you're from and no matter what your faith is, that we can stand all together and we can sing, Oh, Say Can You See. We sang that song because it is representative of the freedom that is biblically based and a part of the fabric of our great nation. I was encouraged to see, not everybody is, but I was encouraged to see that many of the states are now considering, and some have already done it, where they're mandating that the Ten Commandments are reinserted in the school system. I have often said, when I grew up, which is just a few years ago, there were guys in my class in Indianapolis, Indiana, just think of that, who had their rifle on the rifle rack in the back of their pickup truck and went into school and didn't lock the doors. They would have never made it today. They'd have been locked up as a criminal. We have moved so far away, and the world says, what did we do wrong? What did we do wrong? And they have no hindsight to look back. You took out all of the evidence of morality and right and wrong from our kids. And you said, if it feels good, do it. And now they're doing it. And you're thinking, what did we do wrong? But the Declaration of Independence was a declaration that was founded and based on biblical truth. And we salute that great document today for what it is. The people who supported it by giving their lives to pursue it did so because of their belief in Scripture. Our national freedom, our nation's freedom, was godly in nature, despite revisionists' attempt to retell the story today, and it goes on all the time. I said in Sunday school today, I feel sorry for all the young teenagers in our group. If you go to any school, and even a lot of the Christian schools, they're going to teach you everything that's been revised. None of it is the truth. It is how they want the story to be told, not how the story happened. And it's a sad day in our country. But this document had its roots in the Word of God that we preach from today. Our third consideration would be the wonderful treasure that this document provides for us, the Declaration of Independence. Although we often complain about encroachments on our liberties, this past week, I don't know if any of you saw it or not, but I didn't see it. But a picture was sent to me by one of our members. And it was a picture that was taken down around McDonald's. Anybody see what went on down around McDonald's? Okay. And I looked at that and I thought, John and I were riding in the car. And I said, John, why in the world would we ever be embarrassed to tell someone we believe in Jesus? I mean, these people are wacky. But our Constitution allows them the privilege of being wacky. That's the freedom that we have. One of the wonderful treasures of it is that we can protest if we want. We can declare what we believe if we want. We can make our march. We can stand our ground. We can say our piece. That's one of the treasures of this document, that we can do that. Not only that, we can worship openly with no fear of arrest or hindrance, I think. Okay? I mean, today we stand here, we're always wondering for sure. But I have never, ever changed the message that God gave in this book when I've stood here and preached. I just preach the truth. I don't have a meanness. I don't have an ugliness. I don't mean it in a bad way. I'm just saying I can preach the truth. And to date, we're still allowed to do that. That's one of the wonderful treasures. Try doing this. Every time I see that bumper sticker, it says coexist. Have you ever seen that? Coexist. I think, okay, take that bumper sticker and go to Iraq or Iran and declare your freedom to coexist. Please sign all of your estate over to me before you leave, because you will not be coming back. We have an unusual freedom in this country. You can be of a different belief. You can be a off-center of even what our Declaration of Independence is about and still be protected by the treasures of that document. But that's not all. Not just that we have the right to protest or speak, that we have the right to worship, but we have this wonderful treasure, and that is we still can vote. We can still vote. Even though we see the encroachment on our society today, this is a quote from one of our legislators. It doesn't matter who votes, it just matters who counts the votes. Do you understand that someone's trying to rip that sign down with that statement? But we're protected in the United States by this great document that gives us freedom. We have so many wonderful treasures. This holiday provokes our consideration of these three thoughts and the parallels to our spiritual freedom from all that I've just said about this great nation is absolutely astounding. Maybe as you sit there and I'm going through here, you're already thinking in the parallel of the spiritual realm of all the things that I've just said in our national realm. And just in case you have not, I'm feel so inclined to help you think through them. Amen? And we're going to go through that. Look, if you would, with me at the comparison of what we just talked about from our nation's freedom and our spiritual freedom. One is by the flag. The other one is by the cross. The parallels between these two great things. For instance, our spiritual freedom came at a great cost. Just like our national freedom came with war and death, our spiritual freedom came by the death of one man. His name is Jesus Christ. The cost of pursuing it. What degree of cost did Jesus experience for us? Let's begin at Philippians chapter 2 and verse number 6. It is page 760 in your pew Bible if you want to follow along. I'm colorblind. I can see that perfectly up there, but some of you may not be able to. Philippians. If you ever want to go deer hunting, I'm the one to take. I don't see camouflage. Amen. I see shapes. If I could just shoot straight, then we'd have a perfect thing. But that's the problem. But the cost of pursuing spiritual freedom. Let's begin in verse 5. Because it's always important when you're reading the Bible to see the context. Because we're going to talk about a who, and unless you read verse 5, you don't know who is. Does that make any sense? Verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's the who. From here forward in the rest of this passage, the who is Christ Jesus. Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The cost of what it took for spiritual freedoms. The Gospels record for us the process of this humbling, as well as his obedience that he speaks of here unto death. He would be rejected by his family. He would be cursed by his nation's rulers. He would be hunted like a criminal. He would be tried by a kangaroo court. He would be beaten beyond recognition. He would be nailed to the cross and humiliated in public display. The cost. And while hanging on the cross, he would suffer the greatest cost of separation. And in that point, when he was separated from the Father, he would cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? But by far the greatest cost would be extracted on him when he took our sins, yours and mine, on himself. Notice, if you would, going over to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, it's page 749 in your pew Bible, 749. Follow along. This is a great verse. Every Christian should have this verse marked or memorized. This is such a great verse. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21. I'm going to add just a little commentary as we go through it so that you know who the he's and the who's are. All right? Are you there? Here we go. For he, God, made him, Jesus, to be sin for us who knew no sin. Jesus never sinned. He knew no sin. God made him to be sin for us, even though he had never sinned, that we might be made, and notice that, made, not earn. No one earns God's righteousness. We are given to it. He made us the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, in him. The great cost is that Jesus Christ traded places with you and me. Barb, instead of you going to the cross and you paying for your sins, Jesus said, stand over here. I'll do it for you. And he walked up to the cross. They nailed him on that tree. Someone said, what did he do? He didn't do anything. Barb's the one that's guilty. But he took her place. The cost of spiritual freedom. Jesus traded places with us. He set us free and then received our condemnation and took our punishment. Ultimately, it says he gave up the ghost and he died. He died for you and for me. That's the cost of spiritual freedom. No one can come to God apart from death. The wages, Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. We've all sinned, Romans 3:23. No one can leave this earth without dying for their sin unless someone takes your place. And Jesus Christ is the one who took our place. Willingly, he laid his life on Calvary's cross and took our punishment upon himself. The cost of providing spiritual freedom was God's Son was to be sacrificed. Of course, we must also consider the godly nature of this spiritual freedom. Just like we did with the Declaration of Independence, we can look at the cross and we can say it too was based on biblical truth and its focus was at the very beginning on God. The Bible is very clear. Some call this a story. Some call it just something made up. But the truth of God's word, it will remain long after you and I are gone. It is the truth and the way and the life. It is God's word. And the Bible says that God created Adam and Eve in an environment of spiritual freedom. They were so free, they didn't even know they were naked. They were so free that they didn't know anything except for the beautiful provision that God had made them. Total freedom. And yet they chose to obey and they fell. The Bible said, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. And Adam and Eve lost what God had given them, that spiritual freedom. They lost it, and someone needed to be the one to give it back. In Ephesians chapter 1, page 756 in your pew Bible, 756, Ephesians chapter number 1 allows us to peer into the mind of God before man was even created. Notice what it says. Paul, an apostle, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace be to you, and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us to the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise and glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Boy, there's an awful lot packed in those two verses right there, and I'd love to be able to do service to all of them, but I want to stay on point. You all should say amen real loud right there. Yeah, okay, that means don't preach for 3 hours, all right? Stay with the subject. I finally got a good amen. I like that. Amen. I'll do that more often. That's pretty good. I like when a congregation interacts with you. You know, I preached in a church once before. It was down south, and they're a little bit more animated down there. And I'd say, and the Bible says, and about four people say, amen. And I say, and it said this, and they said, amen, amen, amen. Man, I preached for 3 hours. Man, I thought, hallelujah, right there. I can go on. Nobody stayed, but I went on. Amen. It was good. No? All right. So at any rate, back here to Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 through 7, is that there's so much packed into that that we don't have time to do it. But this allows us to peer into the mind of God before man was even created. That is, this spiritual freedom that is spoken of in this text is not as much about man's failure as it is about God's loving design. Before Adam and Eve sinned, he already had in place the provision for their failure. Spiritual freedom is not the result of, spiritual freedom is the knowledge of God. He provided the way before the failure and the disagreement and disappointment and the disobedience even happened. The design of God. It didn't begin with man's sin. It began before God, a man was created. It's godly in nature, this wonderful spiritual freedom. And not only in its beginning, as we read here, and we understand from Ephesians chapter 1, but also in its pursuit. It is biblical and godly in nature. For instance, the design of spiritual freedom is clearly revealed in Romans 8, verse 29. I don't know if you can see that. It looks a little bad. Can y'all picture? Look at that picture for a minute just so you can get it. Do you see what that little boy's doing? He's looking down in the water. What's he see? A picture of Jesus, right? This is the verse, Romans 8, 29. And if you can't see it there, it's page 732 in your pew Bible so that you can see the words. It's a little small on the screen there. But notice what it says. For whom he foreknew, God foreknew, he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of his Son. Our spiritual freedom is godly in nature, not just when it began, but it is godly in nature in what it pursues. It wants us to take on the image or the likeness of Jesus Christ, to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Romans 8, 29. And this is a theme that's throughout the Bible. I could show you about 15. How about just two verses? Okay, I don't want to lose you. This one's in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 59. It's page 746 in your pew Bible. Notice what it says. This is what God's writing. He said, and as we have borne the image of the earthly, Adam, again, we were not born in the image of God. We were born in the image of Adam. If we were born in the image of God, there would be no need for rebirth. We were born in the image of Adam, Genesis 5:5. The image of Adam. Adam was born in the image of God. But after Adam sinned, everyone was born in his image. We have a sinful nature. And as a result of that, as we have been born in the image of the earthly, Adam, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly, Jesus. We have to take on a new image. That's the reason it says in the Bible so many different places about the new man or being born again. It's we have to get a new image, and that new image is brought to us by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. A new man. And so he says, as we have borne the image of the earthly, Adam, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. This is God's pursuit in this spiritual freedom. Notice it again in 1 John chapter 3 and verse number 2. Beloved, and this is page 789 in our Pew Bible, if you'd like to turn there, 789. Always nice to see it right there in the text before us. 789. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when Jesus, when he shall appear, what does it say? We shall be like him. Now, Mitch, you'd say to me, John, I like you. Okay, thank you very much. I love it when people just volunteer this stuff. This is great. All right, so Mitch says, John, I kind of like you as a friend. You're a good pastor and everything like that. But I watched you the other day driving down the road, and Christ has not been formed in you completely yet. Are y'all with me? Some of you are smiling. Some of you, I don't think you know what I just said. Are y'all with me? I don't think, Mitch says, John, I don't think that Christ is perfectly formed in you. And then between this week and next week, I see those things behind you. And I pull over thinking they are rushing to an emergency, but they pull over with me. That's always a bad sign. And Mitch sees me in 2 weeks from now, and he says, man, you're driving like an old lady. And he says, you're really starting to take on the image of the Lord. Amen. Your driving's really, see that? I'm making a joke out of it, but it's supposed to be serious that as we grow in the knowledge of Christ, our lives are changed and we begin to increase to look like him, because one day God's going to take us home to be with him in heaven, and it's going to happen in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. For some of God's people, they're going to have spiritual stretch marks that happen so quick because they didn't practice it down here. We're supposed to be like him. And so this spiritual freedom that we love came at a great cost, and it has a purpose, and that purpose is to give us a biblical focus on the change that's supposed to take place in our life. Spiritual freedom is godly in nature. And very quickly, everybody loves it when I say very quickly, which means absolutely nothing. Visitors. That's the reason they didn't even laugh when I said it. They already know. All right. Very quickly, spiritual freedom also holds a wonderful treasure. We're just paralleling the two focuses of national and spiritual freedom. We already looked at the national freedom gives us freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom to vote. What a blessing. But on the other side, spiritual freedom. Spiritual freedom is a wonderful treasure. First of all, we are forever set free from the penalty of sin. Romans 6:23, I've already quoted, said the wages of sin is death. No one will escape that. Job wrote, there's no discharge in that war. I was raised up by a dad who said, there's two things you can guarantee yourself you're going to do. Pay taxes and die. What a positive. Do you have anything else in there to give me, like, you know, and bubblegum will be waiting me at the end of the term, you know, something. But that's how you can be guaranteed you're going to pay taxes and you're going to die. Everybody's going to die. Job wrote, what man is he that liveth and shall not see death? all of us are going to die at one time. And we fight so hard to keep from dying. But death is a product of sin. The wages or the payment of sin is death. All of us deserve to die a painful death of separation from God in a place that was created for the devil and his angels. All of us, that's what we get for being a sinner. But when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he made a provision to be set free from the penalty of sin. When I stand before God, he will not see me as you see me. Now, some of you hold me in too high of esteem. Talk to my wife. No, don't do that. Just take my word for it, okay? As I am not perfect. I'm a sinner. I mean, I wish I didn't have to say that, but my practice is not perfect at all. Some of you hold me in high esteem. I appreciate that. It's very nice, but it's not reflective of truth. I would disappoint you and make you very sad if you were my conscience. And I can say that in front of all of you because I would be very disappointed if I knew you like your conscience. That's the reason the Bible said, man at his best state is altogether vanity. We're all sinners. And because of that, we are going to be condemned for the condemnation of that sin. And we have no way to get out of it. You can go to church till you've got a bonnet on. You can be baptized till your fingers start shrinking up. You can go through all those things and it's never going to help. You can pray all your life. You can go give to the church and all those things. None of that's ever going to change the condemnation of sin. Only one person can change it. And it's the one who raised his arms in sacrifice for you and for me. And when he did that, the Bible says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. I stand before you not perfect. I stand before you in Christ Jesus. And when God looks at me, he doesn't look at me like you guys will look at me. When he looks at me, the Bible says he sees his son, Jesus Christ. We already read it. Who knew no sin? Dave, you and I are going to get in the same way. We're not going to come up there and say, what do you got in your pocket? Not how many games I want. How are we going to get in there? God be merciful to me, a sinner. We already took care of that when we accepted Christ, our personal Savior. And you know what heaven's going to do? It's going to be a surprise to many of you because our heads will be held down like this because we're ashamed of how we live. And God says, I don't know what sin you're talking about. It's buried in the depths of God's forgiveness through the blood shed on Calvary's cross. We're accepted in the beloved because of him. One of the treasures of spiritual freedom is sin's penalty is gone. On my worst day, my penalty is gone. On my best day, God's penalty is gone. The treasures of spiritual freedom. Secondly, we're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We're co-inheritors with the Lord. I mean, think of this. Not only do I get in by the skin of my chinny chin chin, or how, the chin of my skinny, how's that saying go? Not only do I just make it in, amen, but it's better than that. When I walk through after God says, anybody know this guy? Jesus said, I know him. I know him. I know him. I met him on a jet. I know him. Well, come on in. And I come in like this. I mean, isn't that how we feel? You know, man, I made it in by the skin of my chin. All right. And God says, hey, let me show you where you're going to live. Come on over here. Come on. Come on. Pick up your step. What's the matter? Haven't you ever walked on gold before? What's your problem? Come on. I want to show you. You haven't seen anything yet. Wait till you see your home. And we are co-inheritors with Jesus Christ. You know what that means, Becky? That means that everything that God gave Jesus, he gave to you and me. We are possessors of everything that is his. Joint together. You talk about out of this world, that is all, it's hard to even imagine, it's hard to even conceive of what God has done. But just so you don't think I'm making this up, look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. I told you that everything we say is from the Bible, all right? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, it's page 786 in your Bible. Notice what it says there. To an inheritance incorruptible. If you own an American or a foreign car, you know what corruptible is. So it's the opposite of rust and deterioration. Incorruptible. Now notice this. And undefiled. There are some people in our world today that have gain, but it came at the cost of someone else. They cheated and they lied. But this inheritance is undefiled. And then this is better. It fadeth not away. It's never going to be lost. It's eternal. And it's reserved for you. Reserved for you. I used to do a lot of flying in a plane. Okay. And I just wanted to make sure that you understood. I've done a lot of flying. And when I get off the plane, I have a corporate Hertz reservation for a car. I'd get off the plane, there'd be a guy there with a Hertz outfit, and he'd have Young on the piece of paper. Opal, you don't agree? Okay. And he'd have Young on the card. And I'd walk up, and he'd say, Mr. Young? I said, yes. He said, come here, let me show you. I have a car reserved for you. In all those years that I traveled, and in all those times that happened, never one time did he take me to the box and go, wait a minute, it was here just a minute ago. I don't know where it went to. Never. Every time, he took me right there. I know, Becky, you've been through that too. But every time, took me right to the bin where it was reserved. He gave me the key. I got into the car, and I took off. Listen, for everyone that knows Christ as their personal Savior, the spiritual freedom that we have is not only that the sin penalty has been paid, but I want to tell you what, when we get there, we have an inheritance that's incorruptible and undefiled and fades not away, reserved in heaven for you. Treasure of what God has given to us. Listen to Romans chapter 8, verse 15 through 17, it's page 732. For we have not received the spirit of bondage, that's the opposite of freedom, again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit, God's spirit inside of us, that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. You talk about a treasure. That is a treasure. What God has prepared for those that love him. And then lastly, an honorable spiritual purpose. An honorable spiritual purpose. A treasure. I love this verse, Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. It's just the first part of the verse. But it says this, for to me to live is Christ. I spent a short amount of time in my life till age 19 wandering around trying to figure out what my purpose was. My dad's brothers were alcoholics. Everyone knew it but them. And I watched my dad bring them home, bail them out of jail, and pour them into our living room sofa. And all night long, I would hear them say, I don't want to do this again, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. And 5 seconds later say, and I don't know why they did that to me. And I back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And I grew up, I said, man, I don't want anything to do with alcohol. So I went the drug route. And drug, they're so much better than alcohol, of course, you know. And I went the drug route. And I followed, this will date me, please excuse me. If you don't know the names, I'm getting ready to say, don't investigate, okay? I followed Jimi Hendrix one direction, Janis Joplin the other direction. and down those lanes. I won't even mention the name because it'll stir up your minds. I don't want you thinking about that junk. And all I was I was a steel ball bearing in the old pinball machines, being bounced around by every wind of doctrine. I had no purpose. And at 19 years of age, on that jet, the Spirit of God spoke to me and said, John, your life is a mess. I did not argue. It was a disaster. And you deserve everything that's coming to you. And I did not argue. I had made my bed and was laying in it. And he said, but I love you. And if you accept me, I'll set your feet upon a rock. I'll establish your going. I'll put a new song in your heart. And at 19 years of age, I bowed my head on that jet plane. I asked Jesus Christ to come in my heart and my life. And I want to tell you what, from that day to this day, I've had many, many failures, a lot more than the victories. But I want to tell you one thing I know for sure. I have a purpose in my life that I never had before. And it has given me a reason to get up in the morning and a reason to go through the day and a reason to go to bed at night so I can wake up again and do the same thing the next day. I have a purpose, a spiritual purpose in my life. These are the treasures of spiritual freedom. In the same way, we honor the framers and fighters of the Declaration of Independence by our resolve to live and propagate national freedom. We honor the Lord by our resolve to live and propagate spiritual freedom. We tell the story of redemption. In doing so, we ensure that their deaths were not in vain. Those soldiers who died and the Christ who died, that their death was not in vain. Do not go through this next week being ungrateful for the lives that cannot share it with you, because they protected it for you. And never live your life as a Christian taking for granted the cost that Jesus paid so that we can say, I'm a child of the King, joint heir with Jesus Christ, and a purpose to live. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this time that we've shared together today, for these people who have laughed and stayed awake and endured my ramblings. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Oh, how we love your word. It changes lives, Lord. It changed mine. There are many here today that it has changed theirs as well. But there may be someone here today that doesn't know you as their Savior. There may be someone here today that doesn't know the free pardon of sin's penalty. And I would pray today, Lord, for them, that they would be brought into focus of what we said. The Spirit of God would nestle up right alongside of them right now and say, if you don't know that you are free from sin's penalty, don't leave until you know for sure. And God, you'd give us the opportunity to be able to explain to them how God loved them. And he demonstrated this love by dying for them. And that he asked us to receive him as our Lord and Savior and live for him. Grant us that opportunity, Lord. And give insight to those who hear today. We're dependent upon you. We are not the Holy Spirit. We do not do your work. You do your work. We've done our best to lift you up, Lord. And you said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. We pray that you would do that today. Perhaps as Americans here today, we've grown so familiar with the blessings and treasures that we have that we take them for granted. May this week give us an opportunity to just refocus by looking backward at all of the lives shattered to protect and provide for this great day and this great week and this great nation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Take your hymnal. Stand with me if you would. Turn to a closing invitation this morning. 373, Where He Leads Me. It begins by saying, I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. The Lord calls through preaching, through reading His Word, through circumstances in our life, and through godly counsel. He's always calling. The problem is not with the caller. The problem is with the responder. Let's sing it as a testimony to Him. And do what God tells you to do today as we sing together. To do. May God grant us the desire in our heart for it to be more than just a song. God bless you. Make sure you have a great day today. We have a business meeting afterwards for our folks. We take about a 15-minute break and then we'll convene that business meeting. Make sure we have visitors all around. Make sure everybody, you shake hands with them, let them know you appreciate them being with us. God bless you. Have a great 4th of July.